Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures in place and that face masks should be worn while moving around the chamber and around the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is Rural Affairs and Islands. As ever, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary question, could they please press their request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function during the relevant question? And I call on question number one, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding cross-government action to improve connectivity for Scotland's island communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
As Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, it's my responsibility to ensure cross-government coordination on islands, and that involves regularly meeting with ministerial colleagues across all portfolios, including the Minister for Transport. Work continues across both the Rural Affairs and Islands and Transport portfolios at ministerial and official level to ensure that a coordinated response to the challenges that arise for our island communities.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for that answer. Services, tourism and cultural events are essential to islanders, but their local economy is being put at risk by failing ferries. The message from ferry bodies and the Scottish Government is now that islanders' expertise shouldn't even be represented in CalMAC's and CMAL's boards. Why is this Central Belt-focused SNP Government ignoring islanders, and what action will they take to make sure islanders' voices are heard?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, I refute that claim straight off as well. This isn't a Central Belt government. I represent a rural constituency, as do a number of my colleagues as well. And that's absolutely at the heart of the work that I do as Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs. Now, in relation to the point that the member has raised, we're absolutely committed to ensuring that island residents and communities' views are represented appropriately. And we've asked the new chair, as a priority, to consider how that might be achieved. And residents of island communities are free to apply to become members of the DML board if they wish, and we advertised the recent chair and three non-executive director positions widely, including on the vessels travelling to our island communities, and members were appointed based on their abilities and the understanding of the role of transport, including ferries, in maintaining the economic and social integrity of the Highlands and Islands, and that's a requirement for all board members.
A supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Transport links are integral to rural disparate communities. The island of Jura in my constituency has had a 40% population increase in the last 10 years. However, their transport links need some improvement. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what plans the Scottish Government has to engage with island residents regarding their connectivity needs as it progresses its commitment to deliver the island's connectivity plan and ensure our island communities flourish?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, while responsibility for ferries actually lies with the Minister for Transport, Graham Day, as Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, I absolutely understand the interdependency of transport and the wider challenges of island community sustainability. And that's a message that I was happy to convey in recent engagement that I had with the Ferries Community Board. And I remain absolutely committed to ensuring that the Scottish Government will continue to engage on population challenges, including island connectivity needs, through developing positive policies that we've talked about previously in the Chamber, such as Islands Bonds, the Carbon Neutral Islands and the Islands Connectivity Plan. And the Islands Connectivity Plan, which is going to replace the current ferries plan from January in 2023, will include a long-term investment programme for new ferries and development at ports with the aim to improve resilience, reliability, capacity and accessibility to meet the needs of our island communities.
Thank you. Question number two, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the implications for the fishing sector in Scotland of the outcomes of the sea fisheries negotiations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Our aim across all negotiations is to find a balanced and sustainable outcome for the Scottish fishing industry, supporting the sector today as well as ensuring its future. Now, I'm pleased to say that the Coastal States consultations have successfully concluded, and we've reached agreement on 2022 catch limits for mackerel, blue whiting and Atlanto-Scandian herring, and a work plan to continue sharing discussions in early 2022. And we estimate the value of this deal for Scotland to be worth around £186 million through 2022. Now, the bilateral talks are ongoing, and while we don't yet have the final outcomes, I can assure the Chamber that we're engaging constructively with our international fishing partners to get the best possible outcome for Scotland. And I'll notify Parliament of the outcome of all the negotiations when they're complete.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm the change to tonnage in fish exports from Scotland and whether this reflects the promises of improvements made by proponents of Brexit, perchance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, we do have the data that's been obtained from HMRC, and that shows for the first two quarters of this year, the fish exported to the EU from Scotland was just over 68,000 tonnes, which is a 13.5% decrease from the same period in 2019. And I think that just goes to show the clear evidence of the disastrous impact on the Scottish seafood sector, who relied heavily on the EU for trade. Now, over 70% of Scottish seafood exports were to the EU in 2019, and that was worth over £770 million. The Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation reported losses of at least £11 million in January alone as a direct result of the changes that were brought about by Brexit. And additionally, the organisation estimates that businesses are spending around £200,000 a month due to extra paperwork. The loss in trade to the seafood sector since early January this year, I think, offers the clearest evidence that we've seen so far of the additional costs and impacted association with becoming an EU third country and the trade frictions that that's introduced.
Supplementary, Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will want to ensure that new offshore wind developments do not interrupt established fishing operations. However, the Shetland Fishermen's Association earlier this week highlighted a number of concerns around data used, noting a lack of reflection for movements of non-Scottish vessels or consideration of issues caused to fishermen outside of bottom trawling. So will the Cabinet Secretary look into these concerns and, if required, take action to support the industry when developments are being considered?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would just want to assure the member that we do have regular engagement, both myself and my officials, with the industry. But if there are particular concerns there that they wish to discuss with me, then I'm more than happy to look into that.
Question number three, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what compensation will be made available to farmers who have been impacted by beaver activities.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The reintroduction of beavers represents a step forward in restoring Scotland's biodiversity. We want to ensure that more of Scotland benefits from the biodiversity enhancements brought by beavers. Nature Scot will continue to support land and fisheries managers experiencing negative beaver impacts through providing free advice and help with practical management through the Scottish Beaver Mitigation Scheme. We want to work with land managers to find ways of coexisting with beaver populations, developing support mechanisms for land managers who are delivering positive biodiversity outcomes will be more productive in the longer term than compensation based on negative impacts.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? The Government's recent decision to allow the expansion of the beaver population into new parts of Scotland has been welcomed by some, but many farmers are already suffering significant financial loss due to beaver damage, for example, to flood banks or cutting down trees, and as a result, they've lost crops. Hearing that they're going to be offered free advice is going to be of very little comfort to them when they're facing significant financial loss. So can I ask again, what new financial assistance will be made available to farmers who are suffering as a result of this decision made by the Scottish Government?
Minister.
Thank you. The Nature Scot Beaver Mitigation Scheme is now in place and can offer land managers advice and practical assistance with mitigating the impacts of beavers, including taking proactive measures to prevent impacts where these are appropriate. This includes the protection of high-value trees, heritage trees, landscape trees and amenity trees, the installation of flow devices in beaver dams and, where appropriate, beaver exclusion fencing. Nature Scot will continue to work with stakeholders in developing the mitigation scheme and with new and innovative approaches. Licensing approaches are available to prevent serious damage where mitigation cannot resolve the conflict.
Supplementary, first, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. As Scottish Environment Link's beaver champion, I'm delighted that beavers will now be allowed to expand across the country. It means that many more people can benefit from the ecological benefits they bring as ecosystem engineers, as well as the sheer joy of once again sharing our natural environment with these charismatic animals. I'm sure that there are many land managers who would benefit from and welcome beavers on their land. Can the Minister advise what they need to do to receive a translocated beaver family?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for her question and for her work as Scottish Environment Link's beaver champion. There are many people in Scotland who would love to have beavers on their land if they have the appropriate environment for them. And any land managers interested in having translocated beavers on their land should contact Nature Scot through the email and phone contact details on their webpage, beavers@nature.scot or 01463 725 364. Nature Scot will discuss the different aspects of translocating beavers to their site, and this includes scoping site suitability, carrying out effective public engagement and consultation, the practical aspects of trapping and transportation, captive holding whilst animals are being health screened, and some level of post-release monitoring.
Further supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And there is no doubt that I have to agree that there are definitely farmers not far from our constituency, Mr Fraser, who have actually looked to get beavers translocated to their land. However, I accept they make an important contribution to restoring Scotland's natural environment, but their modifications to the environment can in some places produce negative impacts on agricultural land. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any further information as to what the support from the Scottish Government will be, in particular to the fences that you just alluded to a minute ago, to help negate the negative impacts of beavers being introduced?
Minister.
Absolutely. I thank the Member for the question. The Member is quite correct that the reintroduction of beavers demonstrates our commitment to protect and enhance biodiversity. Beavers have a really positive impact on biodiversity, creating new wetland habitat for a range of important species. They also help reduce flood risk by slowing down flows and improving water quality by filtering out sediments. The Nature Scot Beaver Mitigation Scheme is in place and can offer land managers practical assistance in mitigating the impact, such as what I've listed already, protecting high-value trees, installation of flow devices, and where appropriate, beaver exclusion fencing. Nature Scot will continue to work with stakeholders in developing these mitigation schemes and making sure that landowners and land managers can live alongside beavers.
Thank you. Questions number 4 and 5 were not lodged. So question number 6, Sandish Kulhani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its work outlined in the programme for government to determine how best to support new and young entrants into farming.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are continuing to work on options which will best add to the existing support provided by our Farming Opportunities for New Entrants Group, the Scottish Land Matching Service, Farm Advisory Service and direct payments. And our aim remains that the outcome will be announced soon.
Sandish Kulhani.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Despite the SNP throwing taxpayer money and encouraging young women to join agricultural industry, the Young Farmer Startup Grant Scheme only handed out funding to 62 women across Scotland over 4 years. In 2019, there was only one successful applicant, just one. Young farmers deserve better than this, especially young women in rural areas. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that a single successful applicant in 1 year is an acceptable return of investment? And will she outline exactly what measures she is taking to improve on this abysmal record?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would just say that we are absolutely committed to ensuring that we see more new entrants into farming. I was just visiting an opportunity this week through the Farming Opportunities for New Entrants, where we've been looking at the opportunities that can be offered through public land to encourage new entrants as well. But in terms of getting more women and more diversity into agriculture, absolutely. Can we do more? I agree with that too. And that's why we made specific commitments in our manifesto in relation to getting more women into agriculture. And to really make Scottish agriculture more inclusive. So because women living and working in Scottish agriculture are an absolutely essential part of the future of the rural economy, and developing and expanding their skills really will ensure the long-term sustainability of the agricultural sector. Now, we've committed £300,000 this financial year to bring about practical solutions to support women. That includes the wider rollout of Be Your Best Self, personal development training, a pilot of agricultural business skills training, and a project to test innovative solutions for childcare in rural areas, and the development of SkillSeeder, which is a skills sharing app to encourage greater participation in rural and land-based learning. And during the course of this Parliament, we will double the funding to support women in agriculture of up to £600,000.
Question number 7, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures have been put in place to protect livestock against avian flu.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Chief Veterinary Officer for Scotland confirmed a second outbreak of highly pathogenic avian influenza H5N1 at a premises near Gretna in Dumfries and Galloway on the 3rd of December. And as with the earlier case in Angus, protection and surveillance zones were immediately established around the infected premises, which puts in place a range of mandatory disease control measures, such as restrictions on the movement of poultry, domestic mammals, carcasses, eggs and other poultry products. Now, in response to an increased risk of spread of disease from migratory birds, Scottish ministers introduced a national avian influenza prevention zone on the 3rd of November, and these measures were enhanced on the 29th of November, requiring housing of all poultry and captive birds, and for keepers to apply further robust biosecurity measures, which are key to preventing the spread of disease. Advice from public health and from epidemiologists is that this strain of highly pathogenic avian influenza represents a very low risk to human health and to other mammals, and investigations as to the source of the infection and links with the current infected premises and livestock is an element of the wider epidemiological investigation process to really ensure that the disease is stamped out as quickly as possible.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. With COVID-19 impacting businesses in various ways, what supports in place for business, bird keepers if the worst should happen to their livestock?
Cabinet Secretary.
Compensation is paid for birds that have to be culled as part of our disease response in line with valuation tables, and these are updated regularly by the Animal and Plant Health Agency on behalf of the Scottish Government. And the Scottish Government don't compensate for any dead or visibly ill birds, which is in line with the policy elsewhere in the UK. Now, if a larger poultry or captive bird business is in a disease control zone, there might be trade issues that are associated with regionalisation, and the Scottish Government work with the DEFRA Market Access and Veterinary Trade Facilitation Teams, who liaise with poultry industry stakeholders and the APHA Centre for International Trade, to really try and understand and address the issues and priorities for poultry exports. DEFRA Market Access also liaise with British Embassy colleagues globally to answer trade-related queries from central competent authorities and provide updates to third country trading partners and really seek clarity on the terms of trade where that's required. The Scottish Government will liaise with the National Farmers Union Scotland and the British Egg Industry Council to support those affected businesses where that's required. But I would emphasise again that it's a good biosecurity that's extremely important for keepers to practice in order to reduce the risk of their birds being infected by a notifiable avian disease.
Question number 8, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to support the agriculture and fisheries sectors to play a leading role in delivering a net zero Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to driving action to support all sectors to transition to net zero and ensuring that that transition is a just one. It's clear that agriculture and fisheries have to play a leading role in that. Now, policies and programmes such as the Blue Economy Vision, the Future Fisheries Management Strategy and the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, as well as practical measures like the Marine Fund Scotland and the National Test Programme, are enabling conversations and supporting innovation, as well as helping farmers and fishers understand how their work impacts on climate and nature and what they can do to deliver that change.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Now, given that the Greens, an SNP partnership agreement, has got nothing to say about ending overfishing, it's got nothing to say about ending the wasteful practice of discarding, and it's got nothing to say about landing a bigger share of the catch closer to home in Scottish ports, does the Cabinet Secretary think that's consistent with securing sustainability and environmental recovery for our inshore seas and fisheries?
Cabinet Secretary.
The cooperation agreement that we have with the Scottish Green Party is highly ambitious in a lot of areas and really looking to protect our marine environment. And just because certain specific elements aren't listed within that, that doesn't mean that they're, of course, not important. Now, I would also outline the measures that we have that we've already set out as part of our future fisheries management strategy about how we intend to take the steps to make sure that our marine environment is a healthy one and that we continue to fish in a sustainable way.
A few supplementaries. Firstly, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, President Officer. There are plans to locate offshore wind farms and rich fishing grounds west of Shetland to provide electricity for oil and gas installations. Shetland Fishermen's Association has highlighted flaws in the offshore wind farm consultation process, as Jamie Halcrow-Johnson has already alluded to earlier. Can the Scottish Government commit to gathering and fully assessing data on all fishing activity from these areas and listen to local fishermen's concerns?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would just emphasise what I'd, and reiterate what I'd stated in my previous response to Jamie Halkrow-Johnson. You know, I am the Fisheries Minister, and it's critical for me that I listen to the concerns that are voiced, and I'm more than happy to engage on that to listen to, the Shetland Fishermen's Association concerns directly.
And Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. In light of our climate emergency and the urgent need to give farmers, communities and landowners clarity over net zero, will the Scottish Government join Scottish Conservative calls backed by the Woodland Trust Scotland to simplify and make changes to grant schemes for riparian planting now, rather than waiting until 2024, when it might just be too late to save iconic species such as salmon?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's a number of pieces that are obviously ongoing in relation to protecting our iconic species, as Rachel Hamilton mentions, and I'd be more than happy to contact her about the suggestion that she has there about riparian tree planting and how that will be considered in future.
And Marie McNair.
Thanks, President Officer. Can the Minister provide any further details as to steps which are being taken to reduce ammonia emissions in the agricultural sector?
Okay, Cabinet Secretary.
Now, just in response to the member, we've updated the regulations that govern controls on the storage and application of slurry and digestate by introducing the legislative requirement to use low-emission precision spreading equipment. We can reduce the ammonia emissions from agriculture by up to 70%, which ultimately protects our vital water environment and reduces the agricultural impact on climate change. Now, this will also make an important contribution to the commitments on reducing air pollutant emissions from agricultural activity, which are set out in our new air quality strategy, which was published earlier this year. And through the National Test Programme, which I announced at the end of October, we'll also be providing support for nutrient management plans, supporting more efficient fertiliser use and so reduced ammonia emissions.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a slight pause while the front benches change and we move on to the next item of business.